Hello students, we are going to continue chapter 4, which is dealing with the duties, powers and functions of the commission. In continuation of chapter 4, we are going to look at various references that are made to the commission under the act by the central government or the state government or a statutory authority. The three important sections that deal with these references. Before we get into reference, let us understand what is a reference. A reference, basically general understanding, is that whenever someone comes across a complaint or an issue or any act which would adversely affect competition, then they can make a reference to the commission under the sections that I am going to discuss. The first section that I am going to discuss is section 21. Section 21 says that reference by any statutory authority. What are statutory authorities? For example, regulatory bodies created. To put it in simple sense, Securities Exchange Board of India, it's a regulatory authority. Whenever a company goes for a public issue, or say it's becoming from a private limited company to a public limited company, it might pass through some sort of a merger or an amalgamation, which is one of the requirements, like a combination. In such time, suppose in course of the proceedings before it, because SEBI also grants approvals, if SEBI comes across, I'm using SEBI for the purpose of understanding, a statutory authority, come across as an issue which contravenes the provisions of this act, then such statutory authority may refer the issue to the commission for its response. The language of section 21 is very clear. It provides a kind of a provision for statutory authorities to refer any identified issues which it feels relevant, which stands in contravention of the provisions of this act, for the commission to adjudicate. Once such a complaint or such a reference is received from any statutory authority, the commission shall give its opinion in 60 days from the date of such receipt. And once such opinion of the commission is given, there is a statutory obligation on such statutory body to consider the opinion of the commission and pass appropriate orders on it. This is the sum and substance of section 21. So far as reference is concerned from statutory authorities. I have not read the language in verbatim, but I gave you a gist of the understanding of section 21. My explanation shall be read along with the language that is captured under section 21. Now let's move on and a different kind of a reference. Section 21A, reference to the commission. In course of a proceedings before the commission, an issue is raised by any party that any decision which the commission has taken during such proceedings or proposes to take is or would be contrary to any of the provisions of this act, whose implementation is entrusted to a statutory authority, then the commission may make such a reference in respect of issue such reference to such statutory authority. Because here it is, there in the first instance of section 21, we had seen where a statutory authority can refer to the commission in course of a proceedings before it. Under section 21A, here the commission itself during a proceedings before it, and if there is a parallel proceeding happening like a statutory body like SEBI where approval is required, or a Reserve Bank of India where there regulatory permission is pending grant. In such circumstances, if the commission finds some issue which talks about contravention of any provisions of this act, it can refer such issue to such statutory authority to take this factor into consideration for the purpose of granting such approval or not. And the commission also has been entrusted with the power to suo motu refer any such issue to statutory authorities for adjudication. The business between statutory authority and the commission is simply that if both these authorities identify any provision that is contravened of the Competition Act, in such case, both these authorities have an obligation on them to refer the matter to their respective bodies which are to adjudicate on these issues. Now let us look at the other sections, such as section 22, which talks about meetings of the commission. Meetings of the commission is not much relevant because these meetings of the commission is an internal issue where meetings are conducted by the commission based on the regulation it decides. So this is not a very important section for the purpose of discussion. I'm leaving this section for a general reading, which I would still recommend the students to read this section for the purpose of understanding the meetings of the commission. Sections 23, 24 and 25 have been repealed by the 2007 amendment. So they are not in existence, which will have no place for discussion. Continue to understand chapter 4, which deals with duties, powers and functions of the commission. That is, we have already understood the factors that have been that have to be taken into consideration while conducting an inquiry relating to anti-competitive agreements, abuse of dominant position and formation of combination under sections 19 and 20. Now, since we understood what are the factors that are to be taken into consideration and for the purpose of inquiry, now let us see what is the procedure that's provided for conducting inquiry under section 19, which specifically deals with prohibited agreements and abuse of dominant position. Section 26 of the Act deals with the procedure for conducting an inquiry. The language of section 26 is important because that helps you to understand the manner in which the commission has to conduct an inquiry for the purpose of section 19. Now let us see what the language of section 26 is. Section 26 subsection 1 reads as follows. On receipt of a reference from central government or a state government or a statutory authority. In the last occasion when I was talking about reference of issues to commission, I have explained what is a statutory authority. In this country, there are roughly around 42 regulatory bodies. For example, statutory bodies, I am saying regulatory bodies or statutory bodies. When you say statutory body, these bodies are created or established by virtue of a law or an enactment. For example, Insurance Regulatory Development Authority, IRDA. For example, Pension Authority. For example, you have SEBI, as I said, Securities Exchange Board of India. For example, TRAI, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. These are all statutory bodies created for the purpose of conferring certain specialized approvals and grants for certain sectors which are doing business. Now, these bodies are considered to be statutory bodies. Similarly, there are a lot of statutory bodies that have been created for the purpose of granting approval for any trading house to conduct business. Keeping this in mind, we'll continue reading. I stopped at statutory authority or on its own knowledge or on information received under section 19. If the commission is of the opinion that there exists a prima facie case, it shall direct the director general to cause an investigation to be made into the matter. Now you see the role of the director general. Last occasion we discussed the appointment of director general, but his role and his necessity is figuring out over here. So basically, if a prima facie case is identified by the commission, it can ask the director general to conduct an investigation, provided it has a proviso that if the subject matter of the information received is, in the opinion of the commission, substantially the same or has been covered by any previous information received, then the new information may be clubbed with the previous information, which means there can be at times that two complaints can come in, but they may relate to the same. At the end of the day, anything that adversely affects the competition shall be taken into consideration. It may so happen that sometime we can receive two complaints relating to one combination which is considered as contravening sections 5 and section 6. In such case, both the complaints can be clubbed together and they can be read and taken up for the purpose of investigation. Now let us see subsection 2, where on receipt of a reference from the central government or the state government or statutory body. You understand central government and state government, statutory authority has been clarified. Or information received under section 19, the commission is of the opinion that there exists a prima facie case, it shall close the matter forthwith and pass orders as it deems fit and send a copy of its order to the central government or the state government or the statutory authority or the parties concerned as the case may be. Subsection 2 is a clear conferment of power to the commission, where it says if it prima facie identifies the matter is of a substantial issue which will lead to adverse impact on the competition regime in India, then it can pass orders and such orders will be supplied to the government authorities and the persons who are concerned with it. So the power under subsection 2 is quite clear. What is the difference between subsection 1 and 2 is, in subsection 1, a prima facie case, if it feels, it can either send it for an inquiry under the Director General's investigation, or two, it can pass under subsection 2, it can directly pass an order to that effect if it finds that prima facie there is a case which adversely affects the competition regime. Now, let us look at subsection 3. Subsection 3 mainly talks about what the Director General should do in course of investigation is concerned. The Director General shall, on receipt of a direction under subsection 1, submit a report on his findings within such period as may be specified by the Commission. It's very simple. Let's relate his role like a police officer. The police officer is ought to be have conduct an investigation and submit a report to the court. Similarly, the Commission also will direct the Director General to carry out an investigation, give its finding within a specified time. The language is more or less the same. Going forward, under subsection 4, the Commission may forward a copy of the report referred to in subsection 3 to the parties concerned, provided that in case of investigation is caused to be made based on reference received from the central government or the state government or statute authority, the Commission shall forward a copy of the report referred to in subsection 3 to the central government or the state government or to the statute authority, as the case may be. Basically, what section 4 talks about is whatever investigation report is being prepared or being prepared by the Commission under the aegis of the Director General, a copy of the same shall be supplied to the party concerned, the central government, the state government, or any statutory authority where a reference by it has been made. The language is very simple. And now let's move on to subsection 5. Subsection 5 of section 26 reads as follows. If the report of the Director General referred to in subsection 3 recommends that there is no contravention of the provisions of this Act, the Commission shall invite objections or suggestions from the central government or the state government or the statutory authority or the parties concerned, as the case may be, on such report of the Director General. Let me clarify the language of this. If the report of the Director General, suppose, gives a finding that there is no contravention, even in such circumstances, the referring authorities, the referring government, the referring central and state government, and also the party concerned are given a hearing for the purpose of inviting their objections and suggestions as may be required. Now, this is basically satisfying the principle of audi altum partum, giving a notice to the other side, telling them that, see, an investigation has been conducted and the findings of the investigation report are as follows and which are open and disclosed to the parties which have made the reference. So, subsection 6 also provides a similar kind of a provision. If after the consideration of the objections and suggestions referred to in subsection 5, if any, the Commission agrees with the recommendations of the Director General, it shall close the matter forthwith and pass orders as it deems fit and communicate its orders to the central government or the state government or the statutory authority or the parties concerned, as the case may be. All throughout, subsection 6 or section 5, if were to be understood together, there is a power conferred upon the Commission not only to affirm or agree, go with the Director General's finding, or it can give a hearing to the government, the state government, or the statutory authority, or the persons concerned. Further, it can also, if it concurs with the views of the Director General, pass appropriate orders as it feels deemed and fit and proper and allow. Let us read subsection 7. The language of subsection 7 is as follows. If after the consideration of the objections or suggestions referred to in subsection 5, if any, the Commission is of the opinion that further investigations is called for, it may direct further investigation into matter by the Director General or cause further inquiry to be made by in the matter or itself proceed with further inquiry into the matter in accordance with the provisions of this Act. Subsection 8 reads as follows. If the report of the Director General referred to in subsection 3 recommends that there is a contravention of any of the provisions of this Act, the Commission is of the opinion that the further inquiry is called for, it shall inquire into such contravention in accordance with the provisions of the Act. Let us see, understand subsection 5, 6, 7 and 8 together. Subsection 5, as I said and as I read, subsection 5 talks about a situation where the Director General would have observed in his finding that there is no contravention with regard to the provisions of the Act which are referred to it by the central government or the state government or a statutory authority or parties concerned. So, on such note, on such finding, the Commission may invite suggestions and objections from the respective authorities which has referred the matter to it or for the person who is referred to it. And under subsection 6, if it feels, after hearing the suggestions and invitation from the central government, state government and the party referred to it, it can close the matter forthwith. However, a situation is little different under subsection 6. However, under subsection 7, if the Commission feels there is an additional inquiry required for the purpose of dealing with the situation held under subsection 5, the Commission can carry out a further investigation into the matter. Under subsection 8, the situation is little different. As to subsection 8 situation is where the Director General holds that or gives a finding that there is a contravention of the provisions of the Act. In such event, certain power has been conferred upon the Commission to carry out a further investigation by giving a copy of the notice to the central government, state government and statutory authority or the parties concerned. This explanation shall be borne in mind and shall be read along with the language captured under subsection 5, subsection 6, subsection 7, subsection 8 of section 26. Continue with chapter 4. Now that we have understood the factors that have to be taken into consideration for an inquiry to be initiated and the manner in which the inquiry shall be conducted and the powers of the investigative authorities, that is the Director General and also the Commission, to probe into an issue brought to its reference. Once an inquiry or investigation is completed and if there is a finding which goes adverse or which gives a finding that there has been contravention of the provisions of the Act, what orders can be passed by the Commission? This aspect is covered under section 27 of the Competition Act. The language of section 27 reads as follows. The orders of the Commission after inquiry into agreements or abuse of dominant position, where after the inquiry of the Commission finds that any agreement referred to in section 3 or action of an enterprise in a dominant position is in contravention of section 3 or section 4, as the case may be, it may pass all or any of the following orders, namely. Here the catchwords relevant are all or any of the order, any of the following orders. Now let us see what are the all orders it can pass or any of these following orders it can pass. See, it's relevant here based on the quantum of contravention. It may be the discretion of the Commission to pass any order that is captured under section 27 of the Act. Now let us see what is the first order it can pass. A. It can direct any enterprise or association of an enterprise or a person or association of persons, as the case may be involved in such agreement or abuse of dominant position, to discontinue and not to re-enter such agreement or discontinue such abuse of dominant position, as the case may be. As the language is quite clear, the Commission will ensure that if any agreement that's being concluded or if the abuse of dominant position is being done, it will try to ensure by an order of passed by it that such an activity or act will not reoccur. This subsection A order is a very important order, which should be useful initial stricture that a Commission can impose. B of section 27 reads as follows. The Commission, I am adding the word Commission for before each of the provision that I am dealing with. The Commission may impose such penalty as it may deem fit, which shall not be more than 10% of the average of the turnover of the last three preceding financial years upon each of such persons or enterprise which are parties to agreements or abuse. Language is quite clear. There is some sort of a penalty imposed here which can be up to 10% of the average turnover of the last three preceding financial years. There is a slab laid down. The three preceding financial year turnover of the individual who is indulged in contravention of the provisions or act of dealing with prohibited agreement or abuse of dominant position, a penalty can be imposed up to 10% on the 3 preceding financial year of the turnover of that particular company or enterprise, provided that in case of any agreement referred to in section 3 has been entered into by a cartel, the commission may impose upon each producer, seller, distributor, trader or a service provider included in that cartel a penalty up to 3 times of its profit for each year of the continuance of such agreement, or 10% of its turnover for each year of the continuance of such agreement, whichever is higher. The language is quite clear. See, once a cartel is found, cartel means a combination of many entities in it. It can be an individual, it can be a producer. Like I said, a producer, a seller or a distributor all can get together, gang up and form a cartel and throw somebody out. If there is a finding to that extent that a cartel has indulged in an activity which contravenes the provisions of this act, in that case, the commission clearly demarcates the manner in which the penalty is imposed. Penalty is up to 10%, and also penalty 10% which is read from subsection B, but it also imposes a penalty on each participant who indulged in formation of a cartel and has caused an adverse effect to the competition regime in India. This is an interesting factor, which means you must bear in mind the focus or the orders of the commission passed for contravening of the provisions of the act is just not focused on an enterprise alone. It can also impose on every individual associated with it. Let's see the other orders that can be passed by the commission. Under subsection D, the commission may direct that the agreements shall stand modified to the extent in the manner as may be specified in the order of the commission. Now, this is a very interesting power of the commission. The commission at times, very formative stage of a transaction which is challenged to adversely affect competition, in such event, if there is a finding to that extent, and the commission can pass orders of this nature where it can say modify such agreement to remove all those wordings or the language or phrases captured in it for the purpose of removing all anti-competitive elements in it. Very interesting power on the commission where it can pass such orders. Now, let us see the other power of the commission to pass orders. E. The commission can direct the enterprise concerned to abide by such other orders as the commission may pass and comply with the direction, including payment of costs, if any. Now, this is again elaborate powers of the commission. Please bear in mind, these powers to pass orders on the commission are conferred, and every order passed by the commission shall meet the objectives for which the Competition Act is enacted. So, this is like giving a wider power. See, direct, if you observe this reading of subsection E, it has the power to direct enterprises concerned to abide by such orders of the commission may pass and comply with the directions, including payment of costs. So, there is also not just giving direction, but also imposition of cost on any of the enterprises which acts against the orders passed by the commission. Now, let us see the orders passed, the other powers conferred upon the commission at subsection G of this section. G reads as follows: pass such other order or issue such direction as it deemed fit. Now, this is an absolute discretionary power upon the commission. These things, some of the orders discussed here from A to E, are just prescriptive, statutorily provided. But in addition to this, it is conferring an additional power to allow its wisdom to prevail upon the given issue and pass appropriate orders. When you look at the language of it, it is quite clear that maximum power is conferred upon the commission to pass any relevant order which is necessary for the purpose of giving effective implementation of the act. The commission can pass orders to ensure that the section 3 and 4 of the Competition Act do not stand contravened, or it also to keep its objectives in mind, to ensure that the objectives of the main act are adhered to. Let us see, there is a proviso which runs with the powers conferred upon it, provided the language after subsection G reads as follows: provided that while passing the orders under this section, if the commission comes to the finding that an enterprise in contravention of section 3 or section 4 of the act is a member, please pay attention to the language I am reading, is a member of a group as defined in clause B of the explanation of section 5 of the act, and other members of such group are also responsible for or have contributed to such a contravention, then it may pass orders under this section against such members of the group. This is a kind of power given upon the commission to impose a penalty or pass such strictures in form of orders on those members who are associated with to act in contravention of section 3 and 4 of the Competition Act. This proviso also gives an add-on power to the commission to deal with not just enterprises but also with individual persons who have contravened the, who have contributed to the contravention of section 3 and section 4. With that, the powers conferred upon the commission, you must bear in mind that they are quite elaborative, and the commission has been conferred these powers to ensure that the objectives of the act are given meaningful enforceability. With that, we conclude the orders that can be passed after the inquiry findings have been given to the commission.